worship together in Vigeans Church. It's always good to come together as part of God's family and encourage one another by our presence here. And for those that watch later on, trust you feel very much part of the family here at St. Vigeans. You'll notice from the intimations on the bulletin that you received when you came in, we've got music in St. Vigeans again this afternoon at 2:30. But it's Red Rock music, something that's going to be different, something that's going to be exciting. And so we invite you to come along this afternoon and support the music in St. Vigeans. And then the other things there. Then, with the elders, please check the distribution packs that you've been given to make sure that you've not got somebody else's pack, because apparently there's a pack short today. So if you wouldn't mind checking that, please, and just make sure that the ones that you've got are the ones for your district, that would be great. Thank you very much. So our verse this week is, "Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power." And it's great when we come together like this that we're encouraging one another, and we're encouraging one another to be strong in the Lord. And so let's give thanks before we start our service this morning for the offerings that we brought and placed before him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we have so many reasons to say thank you to you. We thank you that you're a generous and gracious and merciful God. We thank you that you're one who loves to give. And so this morning we bring our offerings and put them before you. We pray that you will accept these offerings as we present them before you, so we present ourselves in your service. And so at the start of our service this morning, help us to be still and to wait upon you so that we can hear your still small voice. We thank you for your promise to be with us as we've gathered together in your name. So we thank you for our morning offering in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing the first two hymns there. Just remain seated. Jesus is the name we honour. Jesus is the name we praise. Majestic name above all other names.
Focus my eyes on you, O Lord. Focus my eyes on you.
immortal, invisible, God only wise. Let's pray together. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege we have to come together and worship. We come as a church family, from the youngest to the oldest person here today. We thank you that we can call you Abba, Father, our Father. And so draw close to each one of us. Help us to draw close to each other in worship today. We thank you for your promise to meet with us when we gather together in your name. And so we say welcome, Holy Spirit. May we all be aware of your presence alongside us. We thank you that you have called each one of us by name and that you know all about us. You are the Good Shepherd who wants to lead us forward as you say, come, follow me. But we're sorry. We've not always listened to that still small voice, often wanting to go our own way and wandering off, doing our own thing. But we thank you that you come looking for us to bring us back to follow you. May we be like David, who had the confidence and the assurance to say, the Lord is my shepherd. He leads me. And so this morning, as we gather together to praise and worship you, may everything we say and do be to your glory. Lift us above anything that would hinder us from worshipping you as we should, in spirit and in truth. Help us to be still and to wait upon you, so that our faith may be built up and know it will be to your good and to your glory as we fellowship together. Father, we thank you that as a company of your people, we are met here in your presence this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. Oh, well then, here we are. A beautiful warm day, and we've decided it's more important to come together and worship in church, isn't it? Because, well, too much sun can be bad for us, so it's nice to be cool. Anyway, you had a good week this week? Yes. What sort of things have you been doing? Oh, you had a ballet show, right. Great stuff. So you like dancing? I've got a granddaughter that loves dancing as well, and was part of a show down in London. Yes, so what else have you been doing? Oh, right. Well, that has a double meaning. But we'll not go into that. Anyway, I learned this week that you're going to be having a new headmaster at Inverbrothock School come August, because Mrs. Morrison has retired. She retired last month, or at the end of the Easter holiday, or at Easter holiday time. And then it's Mrs. Christie that's acting head just now. Yes? Anyway, you pick things up all the time. I went to do a visit on Tuesday, and the person that I was visiting was sitting outside, and his wife said to me, "Where's your bonnet?" I thought, oh, I forgot to bring my cap with me. Went into the house and brought me out a lovely straw hat, because when you're a wee bit thin on the thatch, you need something to protect you. So it was great sitting in the garden, chatting away. But anyway, briefly, because there's a lot to get through this morning. A Sunday wouldn't be a Sunday unless I brought my bag along, would it? Right. Now, what do you think I've got in my bag? Did you read the bulletin? What did it say? It said, be strong. I don't know. Right. Who's the strongest amongst you? Right. Well, I don't want Mum to do it. There you are. I need a bit of thread broken off. Can you break that off? Well, Mum will do it then. Yes, you were. So, a single bit of thread, easily broken, isn't it? Right. I've got another bit here. What about book? Do you want to try? It's a bit harder. Now, I wonder why it's a bit harder. Because it's more thick. That means there are more strands. Okay? Well, let's have a look. Yep. You want to go as well? No? Right? Why was it harder to break that one? Because there's even more, all joined together. Right. Now, what about here? What do you think I've got in here? No, there's not scissors. Because that would be cheating. No. Right. It's so hard to break because there are so many strands all woven together to give it strength. It's the sort of thing that we need to remember when we come to church. We all need each other to give us strength as a congregation, because there are so many different things happening that we all need to be wound together with Jesus at the centre. Because I've had to singe the end of these so that it doesn't unravel. Jesus wants to be in our heart. He wants to be there so that together we can be strong in Him. So we saw that it was fine and easy to break a single thread. A bit harder when it's a bit string. And certainly a ball of wool. But they've all got their own uses. Doesn't matter whether it's as one or together. We've all got a use as long as Jesus is at the centre. So just remember, we need each other to support each other. Now, I've also got, very quickly, have you heard of the wee church moose? No? Well, are you going on holiday? No? Not even going up to Lunen Bay? Or going along to the West Link or somewhere? Well, this is for everyone. I've got my wee church moose. And I want you to take a wee church moose, this is for anybody by the way, and take a photograph of where the wee church moose ends up. Now it may be Lunen Bay, it may be you just go for a roam round our road, but it may be somewhere so that at the end of the holidays we can have pictures put up to show where our wee moose got to. Because we don't have mouse traps in church. We just have a wee church moose. So I want you to see me afterwards and we'll make sure you get a mouse to take with you and take a photograph of where your mouse ends up when you go away over the holiday period, okay? So that's my wee church moose. And maybe you want to name the mouse, okay, rather than a wee church moose. So see me afterwards, make sure you get a mouse. Now today is also a special day for Fun Club, isn't it? Because we come to the prize giving. There's this Jim and Sandra that want to.
Climax of the year of working with the children, and we've done so many different things throughout the year, and we've created so many different learning experiences, and thanks to all the leaders and helpers who put in so much effort to make the children's experiences so varied and so worthwhile. So a great big thank you to everyone who did that, and also thanks to the children for being such a wonderful group to work with. We really love you all, and it's a great pleasure to be with you. So, as a wee reward, a wee token of appreciation for all that you've done, we've got some exciting books for you. There were a few of us away last weekend, was it, that a Scripture Union session in Dundee, which was very, very good and worthwhile, and Scripture Union had a book stand there, so it couldn't have worked out better for us, with a grand selection of books to get for you. So, Gerda and Sandra looked carefully and tried to find things that they thought were going to be the most suitable. So I'll ask Keith to present the books to you. If you ask, this one is for Anna. Says the awesome, super, fantastic, forever party. Oh, I hope I get to read this after you've read it. And this one is for Kate. as well, it's the 1 o'clock miracle, a true story about trusting the words of Jesus. And this one is to be given to Jade Russell. Jessica with us, or Hannah, or Amy, but I will give this one to Jade to go to Jessica, and this is The Garden, the Curtain, and the Cross. So, there you are.
Let's just pray together and give thanks to God for the work of the Fun Club. Gracious Lord and loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the work undertaken week by week in the Fun Club. We thank you for the many stories and lessons that the children will have learned. We thank you for the leaders who will have been responsible for preparing these lessons. Guide them and give them your wisdom each week as they seek to give the children something that they will be able to take home and something they will be able to understand. The fact that you love them. And so we're now going to sing together, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So.
Many who heard the message believed, and the number of men believed
to about 5,000. The next day, the rulers, elders, and teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and the other men of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple, and are asked how he was healed. Then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. He is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the capstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing there with them, there was nothing they could say. So they ordered them to withdraw from the Sanhedrin and then confer together. "What are we going to do with these men?" they asked. "Everybody living in Jerusalem knows they have done an outstanding miracle, and we cannot deny it. But to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, we must warn these men to speak no longer to anyone in this name." Then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Judge for yourselves whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God. For we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard." After further threats, they let them go. They could not decide how to punish them because all the people were praising God for what had happened. For the man who was miraculously healed was over 40 years old. Amen.
Thank you very much, David. Let's stand to sing "How Sweet the Name of Jesus Sounds in a Believer's Ear."
Thank you.
Gracious Lord and loving Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you that we come to a God who loves us, a God who knows all about us, that nothing is hidden from you. And so this morning, as we come to look at your word, we thank you that your word is a living word, it's an active word, it's a word that brings challenge. And so help us to be open to hear what the Spirit may say to us as we look together at your word, in Jesus' name. Amen. Expect opposition, because not everyone agrees. Not everyone agrees. Expect opposition. Last Sunday, we were reading in Acts chapter 3 about what happened when Peter and John were on their way to the temple. Peter healed the man lame from birth. It brought a big challenge and big change in the man's life. He was now able to stand for the first time. He was able then to begin walking, begin to leaping and praising God. When he joined Peter and John, they were making their way up to the temple together. And as we heard from the reading this morning, all wasn't well, because there was a certain group of people who were opposed to what had happened because of the miracle for all to see, but also because of how Peter was explaining and reminding the people of the Old Testament prophets and reminding them about Jesus. And so we read in verse 1 that the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming Jesus. And so we learn that the temple guard was in charge of the temple. He was making sure that everything was in order. And he would have been angry at the disturbance in the temple courts. The priests and the Sadducees were very angry because of what Peter was doing and saying, and he was preaching. And in particular, the Sadducees would have been really annoyed with Peter as he was proclaiming that Jesus had risen from the dead. See, the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. It's been said that that's why the Sadducees were sad, because they didn't believe. The Sadducees were sad because they didn't believe in the resurrection. But they've got a problem. They wanted to stop what was going on. And so they decided that the best way to stop what was going on was to arrest them both. And so they seized both Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day, because we know that it was the third hour of the day that they were going up to the temple to pray, 3 in the afternoon. It was probably not what the two men were expecting. They'd been on their way to the temple, but they'd stopped by the lame man because he was calling out to them. He was calling out and begging to them for silver. But instead of giving them silver, Peter miraculously healed them in the name of Jesus. They preached about Jesus and everyone was praising God. And in verse 4, many who heard the message believed, and the number of men grew to around 5,000. And so the message that Peter and John was proclaiming was to a growing church. There was excitement among the people. They wanted to hear more, because it's now grown from 3,000 to 5,000. And so from 3,000 or so believers, we read about in chapter 2, another 2,000 believers were added. Great to be part of a lively church, a growing church. And after the man's healing and Peter's preaching in the afternoon, people were deciding that the message was true. But there was always opposition, and it wasn't going to slow down the rate of people believing. But now that Peter and John were stuck in jail, what was going to happen? And sometimes things don't always turn out the way that we expect them to do. Do they? Sometimes we want to move forward, but the doors are closed, and we've got to go and look at other opportunities of service. And although Peter and John were in prison, God's word was still spreading, because the people were so excited about what they'd heard. The same thing happened when Paul was in prison for preaching. In 2 Timothy, verse 9, of chapter 2, Paul writes from prison, "Because I preach the good news, I am suffering and have been chained like a criminal. But the word of God cannot be changed." The word of God cannot be chained. And this is what was happening in Jerusalem. Peter and John had to wait until the morning. They spent the night in prison. And I wonder how they would have been feeling, knowing that was this to be the end? What was going to happen to them? Because remember, before Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came, it gave them the power and it gave them a new courage. They probably wouldn't have been very worried. But now, with the boldness that they'd received, no doubt they would have been praying, they would have been anxious, they would have been believing that God was with them. The other believers would have heard what was happening, and they too would have been praying for their friends. So how is your prayer life? How much time do you spend praying for one another, praying for family, praying for friends? And so the next morning, the whole crowd gathered, and people were waiting for them. When they appeared in court, before the council, before the rulers, before the elders and teachers, the high priest and members of the family, the Sadducees and the captain of the temple guard were all gathered together in court. And the group of leaders were there. They'd recently condemned Jesus to death in the same court. And no doubt, they were trying to intimidate Peter and John. And so the rulers asked, "By what power and by what name do you do this?" And Peter, again filled with the Holy Spirit, answered them. But the important thing to notice is that being filled by the Holy Spirit at Pentecost wasn't a one and only time of being filled. Here again in verse 8 we read, "Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit," it's an ongoing, continual process. It's something God continues to do, to give us the strength we need through the power of his Holy Spirit. And so Peter, in the strength of the Holy Spirit, asked, "Why are we on trial for doing good deed? If we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple, and are asked, how was he healed? It's by the name of Jesus Christ." Because remember, Jesus was talking to his disciples. He said, "Look, you've seen what I can do. You will do even greater things in the power of the Holy Spirit." And so Peter continued by reminding the court. Remember, it was the same court that Jesus had been on trial before. And they crucified Jesus. But God raised him from the dead. And it was by the name of Jesus that this man was healed. And again, Peter continued quoting from the Old Testament. He was quoting from the Psalms. He was reminding them that the stone the builders rejected had become the cornerstone. And Peter was reminding them that they'd rejected Jesus, but he'd become the cornerstone on which the church is built. He continued by saying that Jesus is the only way to salvation. When you've got two columns going up, you've got the capstone at the top that holds them all together. And that's what Jesus has to be in our lives. He has to be the cornerstone and the capstone that holds everything together. And so in John's Gospel, in verse 6 of chapter 14, Jesus had told his disciples, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And so the authorities were all really surprised at the courage and confidence that Peter and John were speaking through, because they remembered them as unschooled men. They were ordinary men. Where did they get this extra knowledge from? The same thing had been said about Jesus in the Gospel of John. When Jesus was teaching in the temple courts, the Jews asked him, "How did this man get such learning without having studied?" And Jesus replied to them, "My teaching is not my own. It comes from him who sent me." And it was the same with Peter and John. What they were saying wasn't their own. It was coming from the one who they were representing. It was coming from the Holy Spirit. It was coming through Jesus. And perhaps this is why in verse 13, the court recognized in Peter and John that these men had been with Jesus. And so the court had a quandary now. What were they going to do? Would they continue to keep the men in jail and suppress what they were saying? They could see the man who was healed standing there with them. And so they sent Peter and John outside while they had their deliberations to consider what they were going to do. And after their deliberations, they called Peter and John into the courtroom to hear the verdict. I don't know how Peter and John would have been feeling as they came into court to hear the verdict. But the court couldn't deny the miracle that had taken place. But they could order them not to witness or preach to Jesus. And so the outcome of the verdict of the court was they commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. How must this have felt to Peter and John? But again, Peter stood up with boldness and confidence, and he explained exactly what they had to do. Judge for yourselves, it said in verse 19 and 20, whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God. For we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard. They were witnesses of the fact that Jesus had risen. They were now telling others the fact that Jesus is alive. They were now telling people about the power of the Holy Spirit that would fall on all people. And so the court were left with a dilemma. Judge for yourselves. Is it right in God's sight to obey you rather than God? The court couldn't really do anything more. And as the people were praising God, and so after further threats, they had to let them go. And so that morning, Peter and John were taken to court. The situation looked pretty bad. Yet through the situation they found themselves in, 2,000 more people came to believe in Jesus. Peter was able to preach about Jesus in the court, an unusual setting, but he was able to speak the truth to these people in authority. People and John were filled with the Holy Spirit and became more bold and more courageous in what they had to say. And as a result of this, all the people were praising God. And so Peter and John would continue to tell the people about Jesus. But what about us? We may be afraid to share our faith because people may feel uncomfortable about us. Peter and John's zeal for the Lord was so strong that they couldn't keep quiet. They had to tell others, even when arrested and threatened with court. But we need to remember that Jesus promised in Matthew, whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. We've got a responsibility. Whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. And then Paul writing to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, for the Spirit God gives us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. The Spirit God gives us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. God has given us the same Spirit that we may become the people God wants us to be, to love others and to share Jesus with us. And so in 1 John, we read these wonderful words, the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. We're called to be bold. We're called to be strong because the Lord your God is with you. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And so this morning's message is really encouraging us to know that not everyone's going to agree with us, to expect opposition, but remember that he who is in us is greater than the one who is in the world. Let's pray together. Our gracious Lord and loving Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this example of Peter and John, the way that they were so bold to continue proclaiming your word, even although they didn't know what lay ahead of them, even although they didn't know what the authorities would do to them. But Father, we thank you that as a result of their preaching, they saw people, one for you, coming to know you as Lord and Saviour. The church was growing because of their boldness. And you've called us to have that same courage and that same boldness. Yes, we know that not everyone will agree with us, but we thank you that you've called us to be your witnesses just where we are. And so, Father, as we come before you this morning, there are many things that might be on our heart and minds at this time. And so we just ask that you will help us to lift them up before you. Our cares, our worries, and our anxieties. We thank you that as we come before you, you will cradle us in your arms of love, and that you will call us by name, reminding us that we are special to you. Heavenly Father, as we think of things that have been happening in our world, we're saddened at man's inhumanity to man. We think of those families who have suffered as a result of stabbings, who have suffered as a result of killings. We think of the war-torn areas in our world. Lord, we just pray for peace. It seems to have been going on for so long now. But we thank you that you are a God who is in control. Father, as we come before you this morning, we pray that your will might be done in our churches as we seek to move forward as one. Father, we have many different thoughts and feelings about it. But unless you build a house, we're labouring in vain. And so we pray that you will be at the centre of all the future planning and preparation that's required for us to move forward here in our growth as one. And so, Father, this morning, we thank you that you are with us. We thank you that your disciples came to you and said, Lord, teach us to pray. So now let's say the words that the Lord taught his disciples to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing together again. We have heard a joyful song. Jesus saves. Thank you.
that like Peter and John, they heard the message that Jesus saves, they knew the power that you would give them. And so help us to be those who are bold to go and tell the world that Jesus is the answer to their every need. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of us, now and until he come, in Jesus' name.